message across all our services. So we have a number of different services that are out there that will all work around that prevention message. Our Stop Smoking service do see young people, but they also do a lot of preventative work as well. So they work in Hyde, they have a presence in the Hyde, they have a presence in the young people settings. But some of it's around working with parents and families as well, isn't it? So we know that if your child or parents smoke, you're more likely to smoke yourself. So when we're looking at the family environment and thinking about the first slide that was up around your social networks, your community networks, it's that nature of the smoke-free environments. So we create that environment. So when I think back, when I was younger, I used to see cigarette adverts all the time. You don't see anything of that now. So it's those small policy, big policy changes that will make those small influences on local communities.
We do as well through the Health Visiting Service, obviously advocate smoke-free homes, and so that's a big thing, and take seven steps out. So if you've got a child in the home, takes in your smoke, you take seven steps away from the back door. So there are things like that happening all the time, but you have to constantly keep your foot on the gas.
Do you
want to
just come back to
yourself.
Councillor Gray, then Councillor Meaden.
Thank you. Thanks. I've just got a question about the Cllr assessment. You say that we had a review of an assessment report in 2018. It's not in here, is it?
No. So the report was, what you've got in the report, the main headline is, the report is to go to the Healthy Lives group for sign-off. So before we can share it widely, we'll put it through the policy group.
Thank you. Can I just ask, would it be...
Absolutely.
And also, just a question, Mrs. Witcher. If we're noting it and we haven't seen it, I've just got a bit of a problem with that. In the recommendations, it says it's recommended that the scrutiny committee note the smoke free rural strategy update, which we have done, and the opportunities identified by the Cllr assessment report, which is referred to, but we don't get to see it. I'm the NHS long term plan, which we can see. Are we able to know something if we haven't seen it?
I think that's a very, very fair question. My immediate answer to that would be no, I don't think we can know something that we haven't seen.
Thank you.
Councillor Meaden.
Thank you. Mine's just a curiosity question, really. A lot of people vaping now. And what concerns me is there's a lot of people who've never smoked who are vaping now. So is there any update on how that will affect you in the future?
That's the real conundrum, and you might have different, if you have different public health people sat in front of you, you might get a different response. There's quite a divergence, certainly in the public health field, about e-cigarettes. So I'll give you my view. E-cigarettes, I think, are one way to help people quit smoking. So if you're a smoker, we want you to stop smoking. But lots of people need help to make that happen. And e-cigarettes is one option to help people stop smoking. What we don't want is people taking e-cigarettes, and then people think, is that going to be a gateway into smoking? And that's one real challenge that's been raised, particularly for young people. Now, the evidence in Public Health England is at the moment that it's not being a gateway into smoking. I think I would say at the moment that the jury is still out on that, because e-cigarettes is relatively new, but people are using it, and maybe some people are using it that want to smoke, but we're just not sure at the moment. But where using e-cigarettes has got a role is helping current smokers stop smoking. But we need to be ever vigilant about e-cigarettes.
Okay, finally, Councillor Foulkes.
Yeah, thanks. I really admire the work that you're doing, because it is an absolute very difficult thing to do. It's almost illogical the way people do smoke, and I don't sort of go about the business. I work in the chemical industry, most of you know that. We have cost assessments, we have protection. We are, you know, really sort of quite heated about protecting against one single chemical. And these are our colleagues who are alongside saying, yeah, we must be protected against this chemical. We'll have a meeting, we'll put all the procedures in place, and then they'll go out and have a fag. And in a cigarette, there's something like 400 dangerous chemicals in one inhaler of a cigarette. So how do you actually combat a mindset like that about human nature? So it must be so addictive to override anything that is logical in people's life. The question I want to see is any indication of. We've had now legislation about, you know, premises and places like that. And one of the big issues around that was secondary smoking. So people who didn't voluntarily smoke, but contracted lung cancer as a result of their occupation, maybe in bars and clubs, or Castle was the famous incident, wasn't it? Is there any, now we've had so many years of this legislation, is there an indication of the numbers of non-smokers who claim to be non-smokers having lung cancer? Have those figures come down, as it were, is the question I'm answering.
We couldn't say this tonight. I think we can look into it for you, but I think, I just don't know if we collect that data, but we'll look into it for you and get back to you. Because where I'm struggling is that our lung cancer rates are still really, really high, the major cause of which is smoking still, so I need to go away and have a look and see if that data is available.
Then Councillor Smith, then Councillor Gray.
Okay, thanks, Chair. Thanks, Julie, and thank you for that. Can I just ask, you mentioned about young people and children and young people and that. What kind of programs are you carrying out in schools, you know, particularly personal social education? In the past, there used to be people going in doing programs like that, but I'm not aware of that now.
So you're right, it's not the same as it was a few years ago, and a lot of that is down to the fact that we don't have, it's not the same as it was with schools. Schools are independent now, as you know. There will be some services that will deliver. We have the 0-19 service that will go and deliver some information on smoking cessation. And we'll have some wellness services that will talk about it in a risky behaviours kind of outfit. But we have EBL, they will do some work at schools. But we don't have, I think what you're referring to is the Healthy Schools Standard that was many years ago, and that's no longer operating in the room.
What I can say is that we are, because we're recommissioning the 0-19 service, one of the elements we're looking at is that risky behaviour. So it's, we know the usual person, you try things out, because that's what the usual person does, and we need to, smoking will be an element of that alongside alcohol, drugs, inappropriate sexual behaviour, things like that. So we're looking at that at the moment.
Okay, Councillor Gray.
Main question's just been asked. I have bounced on about this before, but I wanted to get back to what I just said before and just ask, because I'm really interested in this, and your work is obviously very important. Can we have a board breakdown of the progress and the information rather than just go to our own site ourselves, so that we can look at it as a committee when the Cllr assessment report comes? Would that be okay?
Absolutely, yeah. So rates per ward.
Yeah,
that's
brilliant. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, Kai, thank you very much. Rebecca and Julie. We're in a bit of a conundrum because we can't know the report because we haven't seen all the reports. But what we certainly can do, what we have seen, is fulfil the recommendation that's passed on to Cabinet. So given the fact we haven't seen some elements of the report, I think it's a very strong likelihood and you've done what you need to do with it. And it goes into the public domain. I can't see any reason why we don't invite you back to hear the remainder of that report.
Yeah. Thank you, Chair. Well done that. Can I just make one comment? I know that Cancer Research UK will be writing for cancers on Friday, I think it is, report back on smoking cessation services across the country and reporting about the disinvestment in services. I just wanted to say to you that we haven't disinvested in our services locally. And at the meeting on Monday, we were commended on the fact that we still have a stop smoking service within the borough and the range of options that we have for local people.
So I will put a little note together to go out to councillors, but I didn't want you to have been here tonight and then get that email on Friday and say, what's going on here? So they are reporting on a national situation. It is reflective of
okay, that's smashing. Thanks very much for that. Thank you. And I thank you for your report. Just before we go on to the next item, which will be item 7, I'm reminded that councillors can be there for Lee to go to the meeting.
4 past 7.
4 past 7. So if we move on to item 7 then, and you do have to leave, you're quite prepared to exit quietly and slowly. Thank you very much. Okay, that brings us on to item 7. Can I invite Mark Smith to present his report, please? Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Chair. Mine for sub-members' time. This is the usual quarter three performance report to the end of December in the format we're all very familiar with. Taking questions.
Okay, short and sweet. Anyone got any questions? No, no questions. Okay. Move on to item 8 then. Committee work programme.
Chair, in many respects, you've been a carpenter when someone's been on a